Jesus, make us worthy to celebrate the exaltation of your glorious cross with sacred hymns and songs. When you appear on the last day and the sign of your cross will shine brighter than the sun, gather us before you and surround us with your eternal light, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit, forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children.
Oh,
fragrance of the incense that we have offered on the feast of the exaltation of your holy cross. May its sign always be visible before our eyes to strengthen us, that we may walk with you toward death, and then stand at your right hand to celebrate the feast of your eternal victory. We glorify you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, forever.
Through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up one another, as indeed you do. Praise be to God always.
And distraction, he can't possibly be attentive to the return.
because he said to himself, he's far away. And so no matter when the Master returns, it's going to be unexpected. Our Lord, this is a parable in chapter 24 of St. Matthew. Now we've seen the last 2 weeks have also been the same chapter, on the end of the world and the end of Jerusalem. Now our Lord gives a series of his famous parables. The parable of the talents, the parable of the five wise virgins and the five foolish virgins. These parables, which we know, they're dispersed in the scriptures throughout the year. Of the faithful and unfaithful servant that we have today. And then that lastly, the parable of the talents of the king who confides his wealth to his different ministers, leaves, come back, and then wants an accounting of it. This is the context of where our Lord gives us these parables. And then at the end of chapter 25, he's going to talk about the judgment of the nations, when the countries, the peoples of the world will be judged for what they have done, how they have lived. So these parables are all sandwiched within this whole context of the end of the world, which is why the church has chosen to have them read Sunday after Sunday here. They are parables about watchfulness, to be attentive. Our Lord repeats it again and again. Be awake. Live your life as if you were conscious, which is already a stretch for many people. To live in the awareness of what we're doing. Because we have our routines, we get into our ruts, we do the same thing. Six, we get up, we get ready, we go to work, we drive the same road, we go to the same place, we grunt at the same colleagues, we pick up the same coffee cup, we sit in the same cubicle, we do the same thing, and then we leave at the same time, we listen to the same radio station, we drive the same route home, we get home, we grunt to our spouse, we have the same meal, we grunt to our children, and then we hopefully do something in the evening, and then we go to bed, and we get up and do the same thing again, because we're creatures of routine. And our Lord is saying you must be aware of the fact that everything is fragile. Fragile means, in its origin as a word, means it's breakable. And even the mountains themselves are breakable. And everything, including time, which is also a creature, will also be broken on that last day. So what he's saying is be aware of the transparency and breakability of things around you. Nothing is permanent. When we use the word ephemeral, things are evaporating, ephemeral. The word literally comes from the Greek meaning of the day. It's gone in the day. So what is our Lord is not saying, don't go to work, don't rent to your spouse. He's not saying that. What he's saying is transform it so that you are awake, that you are alive, and that you are attentive to the fact that none of this will last. Just before this parable of today's gospel, our Lord, when he's talking about the end of the world, he says it's going to be exactly the way it was at the time of Noah and the destruction of the human race in the flood. He said they were eating, and they were drinking, and they were marrying, and they were giving in marriage, and the waters began to fall. And it's only as the flood began to overtake them that they realized, now something horrible is happening. And of course, it's too late. And that's why in that context is when our Lord then gives this gospel today of the steward, of how we deal with the things that are given to us for a day. Everything we own is ephemeral. Many of us have had parents who have died. And we've gone through that attic, we've gone through that garage, we've gone through those rooms and thought to ourselves, how in God's name did she save all of this stuff? But of course, to her, it meant something. To us, it's just clutter. Now, it's a human experience that almost certainly all of us have had at some point. And what I wanted to point out is that those things were saved and hung on to because they meant something for, in this case, my mother or whoever the individual might have been. But what our Lord is reminding us is all of that stuff, is going to leave our hands anyways, so that we should live with the things that we own and the things that have been given into our care as stewards. We have them for a period of what? 50, 70, 80, 90, 120 years, who knows? And they go. St. Paul says we came naked into this world and surely naked we will leave it. Fortunately, we have family who clothe us, so that at least in the box we're a little bit decent. We're not quite as audacious coming screaming naked out as we did in the beginning, so it's a little more discreet at the end. But again, if they didn't dress us, the body would lay there naked. And so St. Paul is reminding us also later in his letters. This is why our Lord's parable following this uses the term of a steward. Someone who has been confided to things which ultimately don't belong to him. We have them for a while. So these parables also deal with proper stewardship. We have things for a moment. We also all have the experience of knowing people who have a successful business or whatever. And they sometimes can be quite humble, but sometimes they can also be quite puffed up, as if everything that's happened in their life was their doing. Rarely do we think about the fact that my talents, which allow me to arrive where I'm at, are also gifts from God. And to see that everything has its origin elsewhere, that I'm born into a certain family, that I have certain advantages. All of these different aspects are things to remind us of stewardship. And then lastly, what these parables are trying to remind us then of watchfulness, attentiveness, that we are only stewards of the goods and things that are around us in this life. The last point is, as we mentioned, that everything passes. Everything will go on. You look at the pictures from 1954, and the church is jammed. It's not because everyone has moved away, people have died. Everything passes. And I'll tell you on that point, my favorite window in this church is St. John the Baptist. One, well, they're all beautiful. I mean, you can't point out one that's more beautiful than others. But what I love about John the Baptist is it says on that window, pray for the donor. Everything else has a name on it. But the donor of that window, so you know the irony is that when I'm praying in this church during the day by myself, it's that anonymous donor who is mentioned quite consciously and with an awareness in my prayers. It is beautiful because the person who did that realized that they may have had the thousands of dollars to pay for that window, but they understood that it didn't really belong to them ultimately. So it was simply sufficient to put down, pray for the donor. It reminds me that when I was studying in seminary over in Europe, the local parish church at the seminary had a tomb in front of the communion rail. It was a black slab in the center aisle. And that's all it was a black stone with an inscription on it. And the inscription was in Latin. And the inscription said, Ego hodie tibi cross. Which is a very simple way. There's no name on this block, no dates, no little cliches carved onto it. But in Latin, what that meant was, I today, you tomorrow. So every day that those parishioners came up to that communion rail to receive Holy Communion, they walked past this anonymous dead parishioner, reminding them, you're going to join me here. And the old parish church, which was no longer used, but the basement crypt area, the lower church, that from the monuments in the cemetery over the years, the bones had been taken out of these mausoleum. And they'd all been placed stacked in the basement of the church so that when you looked through the grated windows, you saw stacks and stacks of generations of Catholics from this very ancient parish. This was hundreds and hundreds of years old, this parish. And as a 22-year-old, that really spoke to me. Because at 22, we are immortal. Nothing can do it. You're studying, you're learning, you're traveling. This is glorious, it's magnificent, and it's endless. But as the years go on, we realize that it's not endless. It isn't always brilliant. It isn't always magnificent. And we begin to progress in wisdom. We begin to understand what our Lord is telling us of stewardship. That everything passes. That everything is ephemeral. That everything is breakable. It's fragile. And that because of those reasons, we have to learn to be awake, to be vigilant, to always be conscious of the day and conscious of God and of our Lord's appearance, the parousia at the end of time. So I want to leave you with one practical thing, because the eparchy has asked us to do this. This Sunday, Bishop Mansour would like to have us, as Bishop Gregory asked us, to make it as a reminder of the Order of St. Charbel. Now you'll see it posted on the doors around, and I posted it even on our broken door because you can't open it. So, it makes for a good bulletin board. The Order of St. Charbel was started decades ago, in conjunction, I believe, with the founding of the seminary, which was done even before there was a bishop in the eparchy. And the idea behind the Order of St. Charbel is a laity and clergy who join, and who invest in this order for the two ends of the spectrum of fragility and ephemerality. It works for the helping and the education of seminarians, future priests, that this church will continue to the generations to come. And on the opposite end of that spectrum of fragility, it also aids in the retirement of the priests past 75 who have served those decades of service within the house of God. So the Order of St. Charbel is a very necessary and a very beautiful way when we steward the goods that God has given us for merely one lifetime, that they be invested in something which is transcendent, in the formation of the clergy, or in retirement, but in the forming of that sacramental reality of priesthood under the auspices and the intercession of St. Charbel. You will find at both of the doorways, there's a leaflet that the eparchy sent us, a leaflet, there's a sheet of paper, which gives an idea of what the order is. And it is primarily a financial investment. It's primarily a way of supporting the apostolate of the eparchy by foreseeing its future. And so on that last point, that donor who gave all that money, they knew they weren't going to take it with them. They left one of our jewels in this church. And I've told a number of you, I believe that outside of the cathedral, we have the most lovely church in the eparchy. But of course, we understand all the work that goes into not only building it, but keeping it standing. So we've just finished an enormous amount of work that's had to be done over the last 5 or 8 years. We've done it all in one big swoop, finished it before winter, and then we're not going to worry about it. The last project we have is all the leaking that's taking place in the sacristy from the new roof from 8 years ago that you got shafted on by whoever the roofer was. We know that. They won't answer our phone calls. They won't answer our texts. They won't answer our letters. So that's the last project. And that's going to be just over $8,000 if we don't find a rotten roof underneath and rotten beams. Those replacements, of course, will be significantly more. But that's just to see all of the things that we have to foresee and work toward. And for the eparchy today, when we think about the clergy, we Think about the seminarians, these men who are now your sons and who will shortly be your fathers. That under the auspices of Saint Charbel, may his prayers, as a hermit, teach us to be watchful, to be good stewards, and to realize that all things passing in this world, so that as we invest under the auspices of Saint Charbel, may his prayers be a rampart to us always. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Departed,
especially those for whom the sacrifice is offered, for the repose of all the deceased members of the Rosary Solidarity. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Spiritual form.
grace in favor of your only Son, we implore you to accept this bloodless sacrifice from our sinful hands, and through it to forgive our sins. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Sisters forever.
And with your spirit.
Let us lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship Him with humility. Son and your living Holy Spirit, the angels, archangels, and all the heavenly hosts bless and praise you. They cry out and they proclaim.
Lord.
and forgive our sins in your mercy. For this your church implores you, and through you, and with you, implores your Father's sake.
Altar and upon your head.
St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Charbel, and all the saints. May we join in their ranks and share in their joyful feast. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful teachers who have gone to their rest in the true faith, especially Peter, Paul, Mark, Clement, Ignatius, Dionysius, Julius, and all those who endured suffering and persecution for the strengthening of your holy church. Remember also those who serve your holy altar and forgive their sins, that they may reach your joyful dwellings. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, those who have left this world and have gone to you. Lead them to your joyful dwellings and blot out all their sins. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Render us, O God, to the departed, and forgive us sins we have committed, with or without knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever. Amen.
Before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to receive the blessing of the Lord.
O Lord, look upon us, your inheritance, who bow before you, and guide our steps on your right path. Make us worthy to share in this sacrifice, and may it sanctify the souls and bodies of those who receive it, through Christ Jesus our Lord. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the Most Holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility, and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with purity, perfection, purity, and sanctity. One Holy Father,
one Holy Spirit, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy life, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. Thank you.
God the Father, how can we who are unworthy thank you for your grace? For you have given us this divine gift and have made us worthy to share in the body and blood of your only begotten Son, who saved us. Through him and with him, the glory and honor are due to you and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, you are worshipped and you are holy. Bless and forgive the priests who are the stewards of your people and of your holy church. Forgive the servers of your divine mysteries and all the faithful who have shared in this sacrifice. Care for orphans, help widows, assist the poor and the distressed. Satisfy the hungry and protect all who call upon your holy name in every place. May your name be glorified with that of your Father and of your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and consubstantial with you, now and forever. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.